73, we find a song about our Creator. The psalmist says, "Thy hands have made me and fashioned me. Give me understanding that I may learn thy commandments." Now, this section of Psalm 119 begins with the Hebrew letter Yod. It is the smallest of all the letters and symbolizes humility. In humility, the writer expresses his humility as he makes it clear that the Lord is his creator. He did not come from amoebas or monkeys, for he was made by the hands of the Lord. The Lord is the one that fashioned and formed all of us. God took the dust of the earth and formed you in the dark pool of your mother's womb. He used the strands of your DNA to form the features of your flesh, like the potter molds the soft clay with his powerful hands. You are fearfully and wonderfully made. Beloved, God's design of our bodies speaks of his genius. He made our tongues so well that in an average lifetime, we will speak over 123 million words. May we use it to praise his name and lift up others. He created our eyes so that in our lifetime, they will shed 121 pints of tears to keep them clean or to express our joy or sorrow. He robed all of us with an average surface area of 25 square feet of skin, with each square inch of it containing 20 feet of blood vessels. To keep our skin healthy, we shed 600,000 particles of skin every hour, or about a pound and a half of skin a year. By 70 years of age, an average person will have lost 105 pounds of skin. We shed and regrow outer skin cells about every 27 days, which is about 1,000 new skins in a lifetime. To move about, we have been given 600 muscles on a frame of 206 bones, with 45 miles of nerves and 60,000 miles of blood vessels. As we go about our daily tasks and something tickles our nose, we have been enabled to sneeze at the speed of 100 miles per hour. God is a genius. You are fearfully and wonderfully made. He deserves the song of praise from our lips, honoring him as our creator. Our song should be, "Thy hands have made me and fashioned me." In fact, the fact that he is our creator reminds us of several important principles. We see, first of all, the principle of availability and accessibility. Lord, you made me. What do you want me to do? What do you want me to be? That should be our attitude. In fact, Isaiah expressed this sentiment when he said, "Here am I, send me." The greatest ability is availability. So my question is, are you available to him? There's another principle here, the principle of accountability and acceptability. The fact that he is our creator means that we are accountable to him. We still answer for our life when we stand before the Lord. If you do not receive Christ as your Savior, the Bible says you will spend eternity in a lake of fire. Revelation 21:8 says, "But the fearful and unbelieving and abominable, and murderers and whoremongers and sorcerers and idolaters and all liars shall have their part in the lake which burneth with fire and brimstone, which is the second death." Listen, if you have put your faith in Christ for your salvation, then you will give an account of your faithfulness, obedience, holiness, and work for the Lord. Is your life acceptable to Christ? Do you please him by the way you live and the attitudes that you have in your heart? You know, the Bible says in Romans 14:12, "So then every one of us shall give an account of himself to God." But wait a minute, there's a third principle here, the principle of approachability. Jesus Christ is our creator, for he is God. Colossians 1:17 says, "And he is before all things, and by him all things consist." As our creator, he reached out to us through his creation and his spirit to save our souls. He wants to have fellowship with us. When Christ is your Savior, you have access to the Lord in prayer. We are encouraged to bring our prayers to the throne of God's grace and get God's help for the needs that we have in our own life. In fact, Hebrews 4:16 says, "Let us therefore come boldly into the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. Listen, don't waste your opportunities to spend time with God. Enjoy His presence like the fragrance of sweet perfume or the sound of gentle falling rain on a summer morning. But wait a minute, there's a fourth principle here. The principle of His adeptness and acquaintance with us. Because the Lord is our Creator, He is very familiar with us. And He knows us well. He knows all things, the Bible says. Just as the eagle surfs the waves of rising hot air, scanning with His piercing eyes the land below for His next meal, our Lord sees with greater perception into the depths of a person's heart and soul. He knows what we think, what we feel, and how we are faring. He knows. He knows the heart that has been broken and battered by burdens and crushed by calamity and crosses to bear. He knows that. He knows when doubt and disbelief try to demolish your soul like the giant curl of foaming waves of the sea that slam their watery fist on ancient shores of sand and rock. He knows. He knows the drain of despair and depression that siphon the soul of encouragement, energy, excitement, and enthusiasm like a deep wound that drains the body of life-giving blood. He knows that. He knows when anger and bitterness poison your heart like the bite from the fangs of a cobra. He knows. He also knows the devotion and dedication of those who are diligent in their duty to God, even to the point of being persecuted or put to death. He knows. God's acquaintance with us leads to wonderful blessings because He knows He is not surprised by our predicaments, because He knows we have security when life is precarious, because He knows we have the serenity when we are in peril, because He knows we have solution to our problems. Oh my, Psalm 16 says, "For the Lord knoweth the way of the righteous." Psalm 44:21, "For He knoweth the secrets of the heart." Job 23:10, Job put it this way, "But He knoweth the way that I take. When He hath tried me, I shall come forth as gold." Ira Stanfield penned his thoughts this way, "I don't know about tomorrow. I just live from day to day. I don't borrow from its sunshine, for its skies may turn to gray. I don't worry o'er the future, for I know what Jesus said. And today I'll walk beside Him, for He knows what is ahead. Many things about tomorrow I don't seem to understand, but I know who holds tomorrow, and I know